Members, we have a quorum. The meeting of the panel on education will start now. The first item is election of vice chairman or deputy chairman of the panel. Concerning the session 2020-21 panel on education's deputy chairman, I will now take nominations. A valid nomination has to be made orally by a member and seconded by another member orally who has not been nominated, and it has to be accepted by the nominee. Mr. Wong Kwok Kim, I nominate Alice Mack. Seconder, Ms. Eunice Yong. Ms. Alice Mack, will you accept the nomination? Yes, I do. Dr. Helena Wong, I nominate someone from the education sector, Mr. Ip Kin Yoon. Mr. Ip Kin Yoon nominated by Dr. Helena Wong, seconded by Mr. Kenneth Leung. Mr. Ip, will you accept the nomination? Yes, I do. The second candidate is Mr. Ip Kin Yoon. Any more nomination? I shall count to three. One, two, three. There are no other nominations. We have two candidates, Ms. Alice Mack and Mr. Ip Kin Yoon. Secretariat, please issue the ballot papers. Does everyone have a ballot paper and has chosen your candidate? If so, we will collect the ballot papers. If anyone needs to replace ballot paper and or get a ballot paper, then please say so. If not, then we will collect the ballot papers. According to our record, we have issued 41 ballot papers. Will the members who have made nominations step forward and supervise the vote? Mr. Wong Kwok Kin and Dr. Helena Wong. Let's begin. Clerk, please read out the vote. Number two. 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 Number one. Number two. Number two. Number two. Number one. Number one. Number one. Number one. Number two. Number one. 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 Number two. Number two. Number two. Number two. Number one. 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 Will the members who supervise the votes please return to your seats? I will declare the result. Number one, Ms. Alice Mack has 25 votes. Number two, Mr. Ip Kin Yoon has 16 votes. I declare Ms. Alice Mack elected the deputy chair of the panel on education for this session. All the ballot papers will be destroyed as supervised by the secretariat. We will move on to the businesses today. Item one. First business of the day is application for late membership. Mr. LEUNG CHE-CHEUNG has sent a letter on the 21st of October to apply for late membership. According to House Rule 23, bracket C, whether we accept the application has to be decided by the panel. We have Mr. LEUNG CHE-CHEUNG among us. I would like to invite Mr. LEUNG to explain briefly his reasons for making the late application. Within 2 minutes, please. Thank you, Chair. In the last section, I also joined the panel on education. This year, maybe my colleagues made a mistake and ticked the wrong box. So I would like to apply for a late membership.
I've been very concerned about education matters. That's why I'd like to reflect my concerns to the administration via this panel. Okay, so Mr. LEUNG has already explained the reasons why he has been late in making the application. So I'd like to know if there is any objection from members for Mr. LEUNG to join us. If none, yes? Well, you'd like to put it to the vote? Okay, then I'll put it to the vote. So it'll be decided by the panel. So first of all, I'd like to ask, if there are members who are in support of Mr. LEUNG joining the panel. So can you raise your hands? Secretary, please count the votes. So it's going to be a division. Okay, so please press the button and we'll ring the bell. So we'll ring the division bell. I believe that pressing the button will do. For those in support of Mr. Leung joining the panel late, so please press the button if you agree. For those in favor, please press the button. So we are now putting it to the vote. For those in favor, please press the button. A minute, just a minute. Just a minute. All right, more members would like to ring the division bell, so I'll give you 5 minutes. So the division bell will ring for 5 minutes because there have been calls from both sides. So I'll ring the bell for 5 minutes before we put it to the vote. Okay, the bell will be rung now because both sides are asking for it. So let's make it simple. Okay, secretary, please start the timer. 5 minutes.
好，请大家。
Okay, please proceed to vote.
今天是
Okay, if you've all indicated your preference, voting is closed and the result will be displayed. Okay, 24 for, 15 against, 1 abstention. So let's welcome Mr. Leung in joining the panel. Next, moving on to the agenda proper. Information papers issued since the last meeting. Well, a total of 8 papers have been issued by the Secretariat. Starting from July all the way to the 9th of September. So a total of 8 papers have been issued. And then in November and October, we have received further papers from Mr. Kwok Wai Kang, Mr. Junius Ho, and also Yip Kin Yun. They have made proposals concerning the list of outstanding items for discussions and so on. And as all of us are here, and we'll be discussing the date and items for discussion for the next meeting. So here I'd like to welcome all members, because this is the first time that we discuss our agenda proper, and you will all have an opportunity to make remarks, and 1 minute for each, please. So we'll jot down the names of those members who would like to speak: James Tian, Holden Chow, En Chiang, Junius Ho, Leung Che-cheung, Kwok Wai Kang, Helena Wong. Anyone else? So a maximum of 1 minute each for each one of you. Okay, and also Claudia Mo. So much for now. So Michael Tian first. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, last year in September, I believe, we went to Finland for a duty visit, and I saw a lot of things. I think we need to have a detailed discussion, because members from both sides were there, and a few days were spent there. So there's a lot to share. But then last year, for some reasons, somehow I couldn't remember exactly why, we didn't manage to discuss that. So I hope that we can take it up as soon as possible, because if you just keep it there, it's not meaningful. So if we can share some of our insights so that members of the public would understand that we spent so much public money and also so many efforts and manpower, so at least they can have an idea as to what we looked at, and it has nothing to do with politics. And I believe that in education, we should discuss things that are not that politicized. Yes? Okay, Holden Chow. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, during the Black Clad violence, many teachers were involved, and they were inciting hatred towards the police and also the administration. And recently, there were teachers promoting Hong Kong independence, and they were disqualified as a result. I think this is the right thing to do. So I'd like to know whether or not it's time for us to look into this, so that in future, for such teachers who have misconducted themselves with regard to their identities and personal particulars, parents should be told, so that there should be channels available for them to lodge complaints against these teachers, and their identity should also be protected. So I hope that we can have a discussion on this as soon as possible, because parents are very concerned about this. Next, En Chiang. Madam Chair, in recent years, we're all very concerned about this. This is about university or tertiary education. Well, in 2019, I understand that the UGC has signed an accountability agreement with all universities. So it's about students' quality and also internationalization, development. But then in recent years, we can also see that students' quality has much to be desired. And in terms of the ranking of universities, they are actually coming down. So recently, we've got the latest announcements, and Hong Kong U is now no longer on the top 50 list, and Chinese U has been kicked out of the top 100. And then for the Tokyo University, they are already at the top 10. And then for universities on the mainland, Tsinghua and also Peking University, they've already entered the top 10. We don't need to wait for another 3 years for a review to be conducted. During this year, we should invite both the UGC and the relevant authorities to come to brief us on the accreditation or calculation formula. Yes? Junior Ho? Oh, Yip-Kin Yun, rather. Madam Chair, I'd like to suggest several items for discussion. Just now, Michael Tian also talked about the duty visit to Finland. I also agree that we should discuss it as soon as possible, because it was arranged for the last meeting of last year to discuss it, but then we didn't manage to do it. And also, at present, concerning complaints against teachers and also the investigation process and system and so on, they are problem-plagued. So it's grossly unfair to teachers. And therefore, I think we should discuss it at the panel so that we have to make improvements to the system. And then for universities, well, I'm going to move a private member's bill on the University of Hong Kong. I hope that we can also discuss it. And also for kindergarten teachers, I think the pay scale is also also a pressing issue, and we should discuss it here. Next, Leung Che-cheung. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, two subjects that I'd like to take up. First is about opening up the school campus. I think we did discuss it on previous occasions, but then with regard to the opening up of our campuses, is rather conservative. So has the administration given resources to the schools so that they can open up their campuses? Well, I think we need to review it. Next is about liberal studies and how it should be monitored. I think I did express my views to the public, and that has given rise to some repercussions from parents, because many parents complain that for liberal studies, well, teachers would just teaching whatever they want, and then they would just choose whatever they'd like to teach. So there is no regulation whatsoever. And then that would result in very biased teachings to the students. I hope that we can discuss it.
Mr. Kwok Wai Kung. Thank you, Chair. Several points. Last week, I asked a question about campus bullying. 2 days ago, there was a bullying incident with vigilante violence in school. I think they were affected by the black-led violence. Concerning campus bullying, I hope we have a chance to discuss the problem. And secondly, we need to step up national education. Teachers who committed misconduct are affecting children as young as primary five. So we need to implement national education as soon as possible to prepare our children against these teachings. And also about teaching materials, the Education Bureau needs to monitor all kinds of teaching materials, even supplementary materials, and we cannot allow them to spread toxic ideas. Dr. Helena Wong, Chair, I thought I was on the wrong panel. There are so many loyalists here accusing teachers of committing misconduct, that they are out of control, that we need to monitor them. Well, it seems like they even know more than the teachers. Is this the panel on smearing teachers? I think that should be the name of this panel. Chair, I want to have an item to discuss protecting academic freedom and professional independence. Academic freedom is enshrined in the basic law. Now, everyone is trying to smear the teachers and strangle their freedom. they accuse them of not knowing how to teach. This is very regrettable. They are not here to improve education, but politicize schools. They want to turn the education sector red. We need to have a mechanism to protect the academic freedom of the education sector, which is enshrined by the basic law. The latest development is students are dropping out from famous schools in Hong Kong. Is it because people are moving out of Hong Kong? And what is the impact on the education sector? And what are the reasons behind? We need to find out. Ms. Claudia Mo, thank you, Chair. About English as a media of teaching, a primary school and secondary school students are learning English, but it is totally out of touch of their daily lives. Many youngsters told me they hate English subject. However, English subject can broaden their horizon, and it will help them to help them in the future career. The administration should carry out a comprehensive review on how to teach our youngsters English better. Ms. Eunice Yong, Chair, we now have the national security law for 4 months. The Secretary, Mr. Kevin Yeung, said maybe in the next academic year, there will be official teaching materials concerning that for teachers to relieve their burden. We don't have to target all teachers. There are only a handful of misconducted teachers. Most teachers are professional. Maybe the information they found online are not comprehensive and there are no official teaching materials. I want to invite Mr. Kevin Yeung to this panel to tell us when and how he will prepare teaching materials for national education. Dr. Fernando Zheng, about opening up the campus, I would like to talk about universities. Of course, opening up primary and secondary schools are very good. However, the atmosphere in universities are more and more closed. Even for retired lecturers, we need to wait at the gate in order to pass through the gates and get into the campus. This is against the principle of the universities. And Dr. Helena Wong mentioned about academic freedom and professional independence. That is very important as well. In the Hong Kong U, there are rumors that the vice president is a party member. The education sector is not serving a party. Academic freedom and professional independence should not be let go of easily. Now we have the national security law. There are a lot of sayings that we should we should be patriotic. However, I'm worried that loyalty to the party will become the main theme. Now, Dr. An Zheng, Chair, you gave me 1 minute, so I only spent 1 minute. But many people spend more than 1 minute. So, Dr. An Zheng, you can continue. About teachers who have committed misconduct, especially primary and secondary school teachers. There are lots of opinions in society. Many women organizations told me that if a teacher has committed misconduct, why are we not allowed to make public his or her name? There was a case, a female athlete. She was harassed by her coach, and she has been hurt deeply for many years. Why are we not allowed to make the names public? I think ethic of teachers should be one of our items. And also about bullying. This is very important, Chair. Campus bullying is is very serious. We should prioritize this item. 1 minute. I will give 1 minute to Mr. Yip Kin Yun, and then we will start the agenda proper. Mr. Yip, let's be fair. 1 minute. Chair, I think this is very problematic. Dr. An Zheng said an athlete was harassed by her coach. I want to put the facts right. That's the coach. That's not a teacher. Today, I have received a lot of letters prior to today. Mr. Junius Ho has also sent a letter which has not been tabled. So I would like everyone to know members' concern, and I would like to set a time for discussion. We have really a lot of topics that members are concerned about. Maybe we need to have more meetings to deal with the more pressing items. So for those items which are pressing issues, we will deal with them first. I myself have received a lot of requests from organization about mentally retarded children's issue. There are many pressing issues. So I will try my best to coordinate. Today, I think the discussion should stop here. We already have lots of items to follow up. In the next regular meeting, it will be held on the 4th of December. Now we are exploring what items are more pressing. For example, parents of mentally retarded children, they asked this panel to take a look at the issue. So we will work with the secretariat to set a time, because these pertain to the children's benefit and welfare, so we will try to help them as best as we can. Now the first item. Let's invite the Secretary for Education to join us. The next regular meeting, supposedly we should discuss the policy address. Now we have to put this item on hold. The other item is the promotion of VPET by the VTC. So we will look at the situation to see whether we will have a special meeting for those pressing items. Now let's move on to the agenda proper. The government's follow-up actions on the recommendations of the Task Force on Promotion of Vocational and Professional Education and Training. We welcome the Secretary, Mr. Kevin Yeung. Mr. Kevin Yeung will walk us through the administration papers. Please refer to CB brackets 472/20-2101. Thank you, Chair. The Chief Executive, in her 2017 policy address, said that we have to look into several aspects in the education area. Based on the principle of professionalism, we have taken up the relevant job. The Task Force on Promotion of VPET has been set up in 2018 to focus on how to enhance the promotion of VPET in Hong Kong. In the middle of last year, they have carried out public consultation concerning their preliminary recommendations. Having made reference to other economies, early this year, the task force submitted its report. It reaffirms that VPET's integral role in Hong Kong's education system to equip students with work skills for the future. It recommends enhancing collaboration with the industry to provide more diversified and more qualified VPET courses for students, and promotes a dual-track development of the articulation pathways. There are 18 recommendations covering four aspects. Let's allow the Secretary to finish first. First, through the existing platforms, enhance promotion of VPET in secondary schools. reaffirming its positioning in higher education, and also under the QF facilitates a more comprehensive articulation pathways, and also promotes the VPET in the higher education sector more effectively. The recommendations are listed in the paper. I thank the task force for their work in the past year. The Education Bureau has studied their reports, and we have adopted their recommendations. On the secondary level, in terms of follow-up actions, we agree that we have to provide more support for teachers and parents to help them guide the students to make informed choices according to their orientations, abilities, and interests to choose VPET. We will launch a pilot scheme to engage an external consultant for offering one-stop professional services for teachers on VPET. We will enhance parents' education and encourage PTA to promote VPET. We agree that we should optimize applied learning and include more work-oriented nature to expose students to VPET. On higher education, we agree the positioning and value of VPET. We should promote the parallel developments of the VPET and academic routes. Concerning the applied degrees developments, it is a rather complicated issue. We need to consider the impact on the supply of higher education places. We will proceed prudently. We plan to commence the pilot project in late 2020 to explore the details of the initiative. We will, together with the HKCAAVQ, consider how the current higher education system can be modified. We will carry out a comprehensive review on the HD qualification to reinforce its role as a key VPET pathway at the sub-degree level. In terms of promotion, in September, we already adopted the recommendation and set up the Steering Committee on Promotion of VPET and QF to coordinate the promotion strategy of VPET, and adopted innovative methods to enhance public awareness of VPET. So members, please take notes of the task force recommendations and our follow-up actions. Me and my team will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
So I'll read out the names of members who would like to speak. Cheng Chong Tai, Yip Kin Yun, Joseph Lee, Fernando Zheng, Xiu Ka Chen, and En Chiang, and then Helena Wong. 3 minutes each, including both questions and answers. First, Dr. Cheng Chong Tai. Yes, Alice Mack. And Paul Chair, Tony Chair. Just a minute. So you'll be speaking after Alice Mack. Yes, Chen Chen Ying too. Okay, first one, Dr. Cheng Chong Tai. Next, Yip Kin Yun. Madam Chair. Well, in the report, one of the highlights is about the applied degree for vocational training or VTC. And as the administration said, they'd be very cautious and they'd be considering different factors, one of which would be the impact on university education and university degree, because right now there is a limitation on the number of degrees that universities can offer. So where are you going to add the number, and how? That would also have implications. And if you have any initial thinking, then I hope that the secretary can share with us. Because for applied degrees in overseas jurisdictions, well, at the high school stage, they would be pursuing vocational training, and then students would have this pathway to tertiary education. That's very important. But then, in defining what's meant by applied degrees, it's not just about new degrees or new programs. Well, a couple of years ago, the education panel went to Germany and Switzerland to conduct duty visits. And if you looked at their courses, in fact, when it comes to professional or vocational education, they would be spread out throughout the high school education. For example, there would be engineering programs and also nursing programs. So these programs would often be incorporated in vocational education in Germany and Switzerland. So in universities right now, they've already got such vocational training programs available. So how are we going to make sure that these diversified programs can be restructured and incorporated? That's also one of the considerations. That's why when it comes to vocational training in tertiary education, a number of possibilities should be considered. Okay, I'll pause here and allow the Bureau Director to respond. Yes, we're talking about applied degrees. In fact, that has to do with vocational qualifications. So in the paper, we call it applied degrees. Indeed, in many places, they have similar systems in place. In Hong Kong, it's kind of rare. Well, in Hong Kong's university education, in the past, we did not deliberately distinguish between academic degrees and then applied or vocational degrees. Right now, the consideration is that there are actually two aspects. First, when it comes to applied degrees, what is its positioning? That's point number one. And number two, how are we going to deploy resources? Should it be subsidized by the government or should it be subsidized elsewhere? Well, that's another point. We are conducting studies because mainly we are looking at the distinction between applied degrees and also academic degrees, including the enrollment criteria and so on. So that would also be considered under the pilot program. Next, Dr. Chiang Chong Tai is still not here. Fernando Jiang then. En Chiang. Sorry, speaker is not coming through. His mic is not on. Switch on his microphone, please. All right, we are seated in our seats in accordance with the seating plan. Well, I'll be using the request to speak button. Okay, I'm aware of this problem. Okay, next, En Chiang. Madam Chair, I'd like to ask the Bureau Director this. Okay, you call it VPAT. Okay, they are making recommendations and you're following up on their recommendations. So what are you going to do then? Next, who is in charge? If it's not the Bureau Director, or it's you? So is it the Undersecretary or Permanent Secretary? So who is following up on this? Well, we have already said that out in the paper. As far as the Bureau is concerned, and also, as I said in my opening remarks, there are four areas, and we will definitely be following up on those. Who is in charge? Of course, the Bureau is in charge. Yes, of course, I know it's the Bureau which is in charge. But then who is ultimately in charge? Well, seated next to me is my colleague responsible for higher education, and he's also the Deputy Permanent Secretary on this. Okay, we need to know so that I know who I should approach. And also if there are difficulties, we can also exchange views with one another. Because when it comes to promoting this in the secondary school level, I think it's a very serious problem. Indeed, we will have to put in a lot of efforts because in the past and also at this juncture, I think it's more important than ever that we devote more energy to this, because the world is changing and many industries are being phased out, and we have also got a lot of emerging industries, and for the kids, they simply have no idea as to what to pursue in their studies and in what area should they devote their energy in the future, whether or not the personal capability is fit for pursuance of a particular discipline and so on. So we should all be very concerned about the growth of our kids. They are at a loss as to what they should be doing. So my view is, of course, one individual should ultimately be responsible for that, but then he should not be working on it behind closed doors, because it simply won't work. You will have to work with all the stakeholders, including professional bodies and so on. You will have to work together with them. One thing is, yes, we have to adopt a dual-track approach. Definitely, you will have to do it. It's not about enhancing its role. Well, even for what you've been doing, I'm not happy with it already. And also, you said that you'd like to first implement a pilot scheme so that you would be giving advice or guidance to the teachers so that they would be empowered to do it. In fact, you should just approach some of the professional bodies and you should also approach some of the retirees and they would be more than happy to tell you what it's all about and also future development opportunities in that particular sector instead of training teachers and then teachers will in turn train their students. In fact, many of these seasoned or veterans would be more than happy to share their experience with you. In fact, there are many civil servants. They know a lot of things. And if you don't approach them, they'll just sit there and wait for you. So for those who have retired, you can get their help. For example, earlier on, we talked about the police force when we needed help. We also could approach the retired police officers. In fact, they would be more than happy to serve, even if you don't pay them. Okay, your time is up. You will have to wait for another round. Next, Alice Mack. Alice Mack. Madam Chair, I don't understand. All right, the Bureau Director said that the colleague seated next to him would be responsible for vocational training. So what is your thinking? Is it that well, in existing educational institutions, they're going to work on it. But then when it comes to vocational and professional education, it's not part of the existing system. So it's not just about academic studies. You're talking about individual sectors and also where we have a shortage of workforce and so on. Well, many parents, in fact, do not attach a lot of importance to this because they think that after graduation, there is no prospect. So they have no idea. So I can give you an example. For example, for shipmaking. In fact, we need a lot of new blood. But then when it comes to the docking industry and also ship repair industry, in fact, it's been very famous in Asia. Well, in the past, young people would also join the industry and through training, they could also move up the ladder. And they can also become senior management of large enterprises. But then it's no longer happening because young people have no idea as to what their prospect will be if they join this industry. And therefore, if our vocational training can work with these sectors so that they can also introduce them to the young people, and then parents might think that this is a promising trade. Well, even for shipbuilding, it's a very promising profession. So instead of pursuing engineering in universities before you know how to repair vessels. So in fact, they can also do it on the job. So you can also draw the attention of the community to this, or else it would just be academic training and you would just be focusing on individual institutions and so on. But then you will have to enable the community to understand and then they'll attach importance to it, or else whatever you do is not going to work. Bureau Director, yes, I fully agree. Because under our program, one of the important elements is to work with the community. And therefore, we will have to target both the teachers and the parents. Because for people who are around the students, they will have to understand the importance and prospect of vocational training so that they'll tell the students that there are many different pathways for their future development. And therefore, under the different business collaboration program, we've been increasing, or the BSPP program, we've been introducing a lot of information about different sectors so that school teachers and parents and schools will understand this, so that they can also bear this in mind in their future consideration. And of course, parents and teachers might not have a very good idea about the future manpower development in the market. And therefore, we need the business sector, for example, labor unions, to work with us so that we can work together. Next, Joseph Lee. Thank you, Madam Chair. It's very busy because next door, we are having a meeting on smoking. Well, first, on this paper, I have the following views. Well, the paper says that you're actually talking about vocational training and how you can promote it and so on. Well, for the qualification framework, the QF, I like to look at it from that perspective. According to the task force, well, if you were to delineate in accordance with the QF, according to my understanding, so are you talking about QF 4 or 5? Because at different levels, you would have different approaches. Well, for bachelor degrees, So we're talking about university degrees. So that is set at QF5. And then if it's a QF4, that will be different. But then the paper has been rather ambivalent about this, because when it comes to vocational professional training, well, let's set aside the skill levels. So at which QF would they be pitched against? Well, they will have higher diplomas and so on. Well, for parents, they are very unclear about this. So where should these students enter the system? At S6 or what? So are we going to tell these students that you should be pursuing higher diploma or professional diploma so that they would achieve the objective of undergoing professional or vocational training, or should they pursue a bachelor degree program? Because the purposes would be different. The approach would also be very different. If you look at the society's development, on the one hand, people are pursuing bachelor degree programs, others would be different qualifications and so on. So would they be able to find jobs, and how do you define which one is a professional qualification? Well, Bureau Director, I can give you some examples. For example, if it's a bachelor degree of science, so if I'm pursuing accounting, then should I be pursuing this, or should I get a professional qualification on accounting? So at which QF level? Is it level 5 or level 4? It's very complicated. So it's because the policy is vague. And then about 40 years ago, when I was still a young kid, probably you was a young kid too. So after secondary schools, you would go to universities, and then we would go to polytechnics, and then vocational training institutions, and then we would go into different sectors. One would be skilled workers, others will be responsible for planning and so on. But then if the situation is not clear, then when you go to secondary schools to promote it, how can parents be able to help their kids, and then for the students in turn to make their choices? Well, time's up. So please be brief. There are two issues here. First, in our community and also amongst our students, do they understand what vocational training can offer to them? How important is it to them? Because in the academic sector, if we just focus on academic development, and then for students who are more suitable for vocational training, then they would have no idea as to what they should be doing.
So that's why in the paper we mentioned that we want to promote a parity of the academic routes and the VPET routes. About the level, actually we can have 4 tiers or 5 tiers for VPET. It depends on the student's choice. Of course, we need to change something in the system. So there will be a few reviews about the associate degrees and the applied degrees in the future. Dr. Fernando Zheng, Chair. Vocational and professional education and training, this is something that we are working hard to improve. We paid a duty visit to Finland and Germany and Switzerland. They all have a dual track education system since secondary 3. There are academic routes and VPET routes. And these two pathways are interconnected. They have close relationship with the industry. If for students in the VPET routes, they can get a job easily. And in the education system, the students can choose professional skills education very early on. So this is very good. Now for the government's follow-up works, at least we should do better in terms of applied learning. You have been doing that for more than a decade, but the uptick rate is very low. It has been less than 10%. Over the years, there are more schools which have applied learnings, but these schools are located in some areas only, and students need to travel a long way in the weekends to take these courses, and this is deterring for grassroots families. Those courses, activities, and life planning, education clashed with other courses, so they have been sidelined. And also, the BSPP is on a voluntary basis, and they will incur more costs, and it will be even more unattractive for the less privileged students. And these courses are not what they expected. They thought they would have a chance to have hands-on experience of the work. However, there was a study, and we all know the results. For example, aircraft repairing, everything was on the paper. The students didn't have a chance to have hands-on experience. After completing the course, their chances of getting into the industry or progress further up are non-existent. So how can we talk about promoting this VPET if it is so bad? It lags a million years behind the dual track system in Europe. I think the first focus should be improving applied learnings. We need to put the course in the mainstream framework. If we are not putting enough focus on it, how can we ask the students and parents to prioritize these courses? Dr. Zhang, your time is up. Many members are queuing, so I will draw a line. I will be the last one to ask a question. And also, I will turn off your microphone after 2 minutes. So if you want the secretary to answer you, you need to leave some time for him, because we have to complete the two items today. Mr. Kevin Yuan, a brief reply, please. We share the same view with Dr. Fernando Zheng. In the long run, we want to have a dual-track system, so students can choose which routes they would choose according to their orientation and aspiration. Compared with foreign countries, they have spent many years to reach to attain what they have today. We don't have enough recognition for VPET in our society, so we need to do more promotion. We also agree that we need to enhance applied learning in secondary school. However, we should also do that in higher education institutions. We need to show the students how their pathway will progress if they choose VPET. We are not just trying to push them upwards from the secondary level. We also want to pull them up from the higher education level. So we share the same idea with Dr. Fernando Zheng. I will monitor the time strictly. 3 minutes, Mr. Xiu Kaochun. Now, the challenge you said is to change the public's perception of VPET. I agree. But how did that perception come to be? It actually has to do with the government's policies. Now, about promotion of applied learnings in secondary school, this is not the first time I raised this issue. The marking system or the grading system, there are only three grades. The highest grade is grade 4 or above. For ordinary subjects, they have 7 grades. So this is different. This disparity creates that perception. The other subject has a five double stars, but for these VPET subjects, there are only 3 grades. This is what gives people the negative perception. So you should be mindful of that. And also, will the administration plan to extend the applied learnings courses from 2 years to 3 years? It also has to do with the perception. By that, you can tell the public the Education Bureau is focusing on VPET a lot. And also about the QF. We have covered that, and Ms. Alice Mack has covered it a lot as well. In the US and the UK, for VPET, they are accredited by the trade unions and the chambers of the industry. So the easiest way to find out if you are qualified enough is to see whether you can get a job after completing the course. And also some figures. You said VPET can provide a diversified career prospects for students, so we really want to ask whether this statement is substantiated by figures. Can you give us a figure? For students completed these VPET courses, how many of them can join the relevant industry? I think the figure is very low, actually. That's why I think we need to have a figure. Secretary, Chair, about applied learning. Members could see that we have been improving. We used to have two grades, now we have three grades. We will keep developing it. We are looking at whether we can provide applied learning courses for secondary four students. So we are exploring how we can further improve the subject. About accreditation by the industry or trade chambers, our situation is different. It is quite difficult to find the industry to give accreditation. Dr. Zhang. Thank you, Chair. I have doubts that this task force on promotion of VPET, is it going backwards? When we have the new secondary school system, we were trying to move the system towards progression to university degrees. In the past, because of the 3-3-4 system, we faced the reality that some students would drop out at secondary three. So if that's the reality, you should tell us that's the case. Rather than giving us this VPET and studying whether we can provide some interim courses for secondary 3, 4, 5 students. These students may be may want to get a degree from or a qualification from self-finance institution and couldn't get a job in the end. So in terms of the framework and in terms of the operational details, we don't know what this VPET is trying to achieve. If you want to implement the system, how do you want the schools to work with you? Is there any support for them? Thank you. Mr. Yang. Chair, in terms of the concept, I think it is a little bit different. We are having a 3-3-4 system in the existing education system. We are trying to raise the positioning of VPET. It will not affect the 3-3-4 system. When we implemented this system, we already had applied learning. Now we are just trying to raise its importance to cater for the differences in orientation and interests among students. Even at the university level, maybe we also should make a distinction between applied degrees and academic degrees. We should provide different courses with different focuses to cater for different university students' ability and orientation. That's what we are trying to achieve. Over the years, society had a misinterpretation of a VPET. They thought these were not degrees, and there are no VPET courses on the degree level. So we are exploring whether we can have VPET courses on the degree level. So even if a student chooses the VPET pathways, he can still attain the same status as a university student. We are not moving backward. Dr. Helena Wong. Chair, I used to teach in the Polytechnic University for many years. The paper said it is trying to promote VPET in secondary school. In the Polytechnic University, there are lots of applied degrees, for example, nursing, physical therapy, hotel industry and tourism, accounting, and we have lots of engineering courses. Now the trend is, for universities like the HKU and the Chinese University, they are getting more technical. They also have hotel degrees. Are you trying to move all the 8 institutions towards VPET degrees? It seems that our direction is not very clear. HKU, the Chinese University, used to have their own orientation. The polytechnics and HKUST have their own objectives. Now it seems that the conventional universities are providing more vocation-oriented courses. Is that the trend? Second, about the higher diploma and associate degree. What about their development? According to the PolyU experience, it seems that the government is not willing to provide more high diploma courses. So for social worker and young children education, it seems that the courses have been removed. It seems that the university is trying to keep all the degrees programs, and in the community college we have those higher diploma and associate degree courses. Now Professor Cheung has compiled a report about higher education, and it says we want to keep the dual track model with both higher diploma and associated degrees. It is very chaotic. Both higher diploma and associated degrees are VPET qualifications. But should a student choose higher diploma or the associated degree? It is very confusing for them. And you are even making it more confusing. The report says we should have clear distinction between higher diploma and the associate degree. So can you please tell me how you're going to distinguish them? So Dr. Helena Wong has spent all 3 minutes. There are still many members waiting to ask questions.
So can you make an integrated reply? So I'll be strictly enforcing the 3-minute rule. Okay. Next, Claudia Mo. The fact is applied degrees and also associate degrees or sub-degrees and also higher diplomas, they are very confusing. And I think there is an idea that after high school students graduate, they can go to tertiary institutions and then they can get recognized qualifications. But then we all know what it is, because there are certain qualifications that are being prejudiced in our society. So you will have to do something about this. This is about people's perception. And then for VPET, I think the idea is a good one. But then when it comes to different industries and work types, it's really hard to choose. You will have to look at the prevailing needs of a society. Because most of the imported workers would be working in the residential care for elderly, and it accounted for some 44% of the total number of imported workers last year. So can it be classified under healthcare professionals? And then when it comes to health problems, it's not just about humans. What about vet services? Because one of the new faculties would be a vet school. So vet surgeons would need to have an assistance, and they know how to deal with animals and do injections for animals and so on. So this is a very meaningful discipline. So how do you classify that? So can you also consider that? Because there is a need. Or else if I just want vet surgeons, then what about their assistants? What is going to happen? Bureau Director, I agree. It's a question of or matter of perception. That's why shortly after the task force has released this report, we would also have to look into this seriously. It's also about the society as a whole. Members would also have to help us in promoting VPAD and so on. But just now, we might sound a bit confusing, but then we are basically saying that at different levels. We should not strictly say that, all right, this is university, and then below it, these are vocational training and so on. Well, there are different articulation and pathways, and students can get qualifications only then. Would parents and teachers be prepared to accept it? So they would be prepared to go for VPAD. And I'm sure you'll see that we're going to have pilot schemes and also reviews and so on, because we'd like to distinguish so that between bachelor degrees and also sub-degrees and so on, what's the relationship? And then for individual industries' needs from different policy bureaus, when we know that there is a demand, then we'll reflect it to different tertiary institutions so that they would know, and they would then decide whether or not they need to offer programs. Yes, Tony Chair, but of course, I am a graduate of sciences and engineering, but then I think we are actually giving people an impression that we attach more importance to academic studies rather than applied studies, and as a result, we do have a shortage of workers or professionals in that field. That's about parents' perception. They think that this is a less preferred choice. And therefore, you said that the task force will be following up in different areas. But then what I find to be disappointing is that apparently you're giving people the impression that it's just empty talk. You talk about promotion, publicity, looking into it and reviewing it and so on and so forth in a paper. But then you will have to have a target. Without a target, without a timeline or timetable, without any indicators, then you give people an impression that you will not be able to see results at all. Well, coming back to VPAD education, so what are the objectives or target that is within a specified time? How many, what is the percentage of students that can pursue such education, and how many programs run by universities would be VPAD programs? And of course, we'd like to enhance student training and also workplace studies and so on. So when are you going to do it, and how are you going to do it? When will we see the results? So these are things that are not readily identifiable in the paper. So can you be more specific about this? At least you should let us know what are the objectives, when can we achieve it, and then we can measure it. Bureau Director. Madam Chair, when it comes to education, sometimes it's hard to come up with a hard and fast target. For example, after a certain time, a certain percentage of students will go for VPAD education. It's hard because it's hard to say or set a target for that, because different students at different times might vary. But then our objective is that once I open up that pathway, so that society as a whole would accept it as a good pathway, so that from high school to tertiary education, so there would be a clear pathway, so that they can see that there is a prospect, there is a future for that. Well, can I interrupt? Because without a target, then nobody would be choosing it, and it's a waste of resources. Or your approach should be that you should review it. So that's the least that you should do. Because there are indeed two pathways available, and then in different countries they have been doing the same, and they've been successful. Why? That's because what they do would make it succeed, instead of just giving you the choices, and then whatever you do is none of my business. That's not going to work. Next, Chen Chenying. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, the paper says that the task force feels that through the existing BSPP, and then we can promote it in secondary schools, and then it suggested that the administration should offer incentives to the industry partners, and then secondary students will engage in more such activities, only then will help. So I'd like to know from the administration, how are you going to do it? How can you deepen industry collaboration. So does it mean that you will have to work with other bureaus, including the Innovation Bureau and also the financial sector, so that you can lay the foundation for this? And then you also talk about incentives. Well, as we all know, well, given the current COVID situation, well, business sectors are not having a good time. So how are you going to offer incentives for the business sector to work with you under this BSPP, the Business School Partnerships Program? Second, you said that you would be looking into curriculum development, so that you'll be looking at the details, and then by the end of this year, you'll be starting with the pilot scheme. All right, it's already early November. We are close to the end of the year. So can you tell us more about this pilot program? Well, I'll defer to Mr. Lee. Thank you, Madam Chair. On the first question, in the report, we said that we'll be setting up a steering committee, and on the 1st of September, it's been set up. And the first meeting was also held. And this is a steering committee on promotion of VPET and QF. And one of the subjects under discussion would be to look at how we can offer incentives to manufacturers so that there can be further collaboration. So we will have to work together in order to come up with a plan. As to the pilot scheme, as the Bureau Director just said, by the end of this year, we'll start this. And then one of the first things that we're going to do is to invite our tertiary institutions to join this pilot program or pilot project. And of course, for the different disciplines, it depends on the institution's strengths and interests. Once we receive their proposals, there is a vetting mechanism, and then we will identify certain programs for the pilot project. Thank you. Next, Hollis Cheung, thank you. First, I agree that we should discuss this at the meeting. It's about VPET, because the world has changed. If you look back on what we did when we were kids, well, we were told that it's best to become professionals like lawyers, engineers, and accountants, and so on. So we work very hard at schools in order to go into these disciplines. But then the world has changed, and our economy is different. And then there are many professionals who have to work very hard before they can make a living. But then there are other young people who might pursue something different for the unconventional trades. If they develop and excel, then they would be able to excel too. So the world has changed, and therefore our mindset should also change. Undeniably, for parents, they would still stay at the old thinking, and they would still think that, well, for their kids, they prefer that their kids would stay in conventional education, and then they'll get good grades at the DSE, and then they'll go into universities for a good degrees. And well, but then they have to admit that the world is different now. Instead of being lawyers and doctors, they can also excel. In fact, even if they just become cooks online, they can also excel. So I agree with what the paper says here. That is, amongst parents, you will have to promote this idea. I think that's something to be supported. And of course, when it comes to promoting VPET so that it can be more readily recognized by our society, that would be even better, because that's the most effective way of promoting it amongst our parents. But then in promoting this, when it comes to VPET, what kind of industries or sectors are we talking about? Well, the Bureau said that they would be promoting this in schools, and you would identify consultants, and there might even be a steering committee on this. But then what about in schools? Teachers and students would need to understand what these industries are. What are they? Of course, in our minds, we might think about conventional vocational trades. But then what about fintech, technology innovation, and startups, and so on? So we should allow the students to have a better understanding of it. Teachers will first have a good idea about this before they can tell the students what they are all about. If teachers don't know what they are, then how can they be expected to teach the students in turn? And then how can students be expected to know? So what is your thinking on this? Bureau Director, Madam Chair, in simple terms, we will have to act in accordance with the latest developments in society, and then we should enable the industries to work with teachers and schools so that there would be further collaboration. We'll be working with chambers of commerce and so on. Next, Lo Wai Kwok. Madam Chair, Hong Kong's VPAT has a long history, and it has made tremendous contribution to our society. Taking this engineering sector as an example, over the years, it has been able to nurture a lot of students, and after their graduation, many of them would go back to the engineering sector, and many of them have very outstanding achievements. So we should not be dwarfing the merits of vocational training, thinking that only pursuing university studies would be the way to go. Well, I'm also the chairman of the vocational training on engineering, so I've been chairman for years. And therefore, wearing this hat, I understand the challenges and how the sector managed to overcome this. For example, under the 334 curriculum, higher degree or higher diploma graduates will have to get its right place in the system. Well, our colleagues have been working very hard and a lot of work has been put into it. And now things have been going very smoothly. But then a very realistic issue is that, as set out in the paper, well, among some parents and students, the administration is trying to promote VPAT and its merits, seeing that it's a worth pursuing pathway. But then it's still something to be desired. So there are lights, and still you seem to be just exploring in the dark. So when students go into secondary schools, so in order to encourage them to get higher education, you created or offered many sub-degree programs. I'm not saying that it's not a good way, but then in fact you should have pursued VPAT. And in recent years, the administration has made an improvement in the sense that you put in more resources into this sector.
And it seems that the administration is more ready to recognize the achievements of the VPET courses, and there are more resources deployed into that. We need to think about the number of secondary school students. Number of secondary school students are decreasing, so there are pressure of VPET to take up enough students. What Mr. Kwok said was right. Our goal is to take care of students' orientation and interests and provide them with more pathways. About the decreasing number of students, under our current system, if you are a VPET student and you cannot attain a degree, and so students may choose for associated degrees instead. But we have achieved VPET on the degree level, then the situation will be resolved. So please allow the Secretary more time to answer you. Several issues, Chair. First several sentences on the report are key. First, we need to change the public's perception of VPET as an inferior choice relative to academic articulation pathways. To be honest, there's not much you can do to change the perception. That's the reality. And the second line is the point. We need to provide quality progression pathways. Now, this is more realistic. How we can change the mindset of favoring academic over vocational pathways, and how we can provide better progression pathways for vocation-oriented trades, the administration should do more. Now, there are talks that the students should take exams under the QF. Actually, we didn't have the qualification framework, but the trades were thriving. So we need to think whether these QF qualifications are constructive or counter-constructive. Now, if you can take the academic path, people would not take the vocational pathway. So we need to think about the reasons behind. Back in 2015, there was a human resource projection report projecting the size of the labor force in 2020. Now we are in year 2020, but by 2022, the supply of labor will decrease for certain areas, but for the vocational training, a vocational-oriented students, there will be more. We will have more degree holders, but do we have so many positions for them in offices? Like I said to many departments, the system of self-financed courses in the university gave profits to the university, but it prevented students from choosing other courses. With this self-financed system, the university are opening up more courses because they want to make more money, but it didn't help to diversify human resources. Now, I won't give members a second round of questions. I would like to tell the secretary, people have different abilities. People can excel in all trades. We need to think beyond the box. In 2006, I visited the Lantau. There was a secondary school run by the Hong Yi Kok. That's the only secondary school with the relevant equipment for students to take an interest in astrology. But the school was closed. Not everyone should take the conventional pathways. Of course, it's good to have places for students. However, degrees only play a small role in determining people's success. Now the world is changing. We are more technology-oriented, and people who succeed may not be those who excel in the academic system. After the reform, for Form 1, Form 2 students, people even need to take examination for arts and physical education. Now, these teaching models are outdated. On the other hand, for students who took on apprenticeship, they had a passion. They may be passionate about robotics and computers, and some may be interested in conventional trades. For example, shoes making. We always talk about making the products personal. Some trades have vanished. In the future, if we rebrand these trades, they may become very popular new trades. For example, jewel designs and beauty courses. Many people have succeeded in the market. And then, because of for self-attainment, they took a course after they have succeeded. Now, for repairing lifts, we have no talents in Hong Kong. We need to import labor. Even if we have the courses, we need to wait 3 or 4 years to have the talents available. So we need to look ahead about the needs of the market. students should consider their orientation and take these skill train courses for the future. We don't necessarily need a degree. Now I will give the secretary some time to reply on the salient points, and then we will move on. Mr. Yang. Thank you, Chair. I will make some brief replies. Many members mentioned the same goal. Of course, in terms of details, we have different ideas. I promise we will follow them up. For example, the positioning of university in future, like Dr. Helena Wong said. And some members mentioned about the distinction between higher diploma and associated degree. We will work on these questions. Now for the trade as a whole, how can we develop the relevant talents? Maybe we cannot be so, we may not be able to break it down into such as small subjects in the secondary school level. The scope is very wide. However, we can provide a ballpark idea for the students in the secondary school. We may not need to go into the details of each trade on the secondary school level. Now, we are liaising with the institutions. When they create a higher diploma or associated degree courses, they should think about the needs of the markets in the coming few years. We will keep communicating with them on that. And about the needs for human resources, do we need higher diploma holders or associated degree holders? There may be different needs. So these will all be covered in the pilot scheme. So I thank the chairman and all the members for your contribution. Secretary, the members have been asking a lot of questions, so you can see how much they are concerned about this. So the next item, campus development projects of the Chinese University of Hong Kong and the HKU. This is a public works proposal, so all other members are invited to join. The CUHK proposes to construct a research laboratory building at the northern side of its campus, and also the HKU proposes to build a research laboratory building on the University Drive on the campus and an IT building. I will invite the Undersecretary for Education, Dr. Choi. And please, if you want to speak, please press the request to speak button. Dr. Choi, please. Just a moment. According to Rules of Procedure 83A, if members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in the matters, please disclose the nature of your interest before you speak. Chair, the CUHK, the government, and the HKU propose three capital works projects. First, the CUHK proposes to construct a research laboratory building at the northern side of its campus in Area 39, Tai Po, that is Works 8056EF, involving a 9-story research building, providing laboratories, offices, and public facilities involving 12,000 square meters in net operational floor area. The Faculty of Science of the Chinese University of Hong Kong will be a major user. In terms of money of the day, the price will be $1,416.1 million. For the HKU proposes to build a Works 8056EG, involving demolition of an existing 5-story staff quarters building and construction of a 9-story research laboratory building on University Drive. The new building will provide laboratories, classrooms, offices, and study space involving 7,100 meters square of net operational floor area. The Faculty of Science and Faculty of Engineering will be the major users. In terms of money of the day, the estimated cost will be $599.9 million. And also, the HKU proposes to build an information technology building on the University Drive that is works 80564EG, which provide data center, classrooms, laboratories involving 5,600 meter squares in that operational area. In terms of money of the day, the latest estimation, of course, is $561.8 million. We seek members' support for these public works, and we will submit these proposals to the Public Works Subcommittee for approval and seek fund and apply for funding approval with the Finance Committee. The universities will commence these projects by 2021. I will invite the colleagues from both universities to brief members on the works and take your questions. From the Chinese University. Thank you, Chair. First, I would like to brief members on the centralized general research laboratory complex block 2. Now please look at the layout plan. The site is the northern side, area 39 of the CUHK's campus facing Tolu Harbour, Tolu Highway, and the Hong Kong Science Park. There was a block 1, the biotechnology building there. Now we are proposing to build a block 2 for the research laboratory. In terms of translational medicine and also sustainability of environments, we want to provide research facility to support the government's vision to make Hong Kong a hub for international innovation technology center. We have the state key laboratory of agrobiotechnology in the building. Now for the achievements, we have been making use of biotechnology to deal with the challenges brought about by the climate change. The professor of the state key laboratory of agrobiotechnology has developed a kind of bean which is drought assistant, and also has set up a sustainability center to research on agricultural technologies. For translational biomedicine, it can explore new treatment direction for illnesses which are untreatable right now. The translational medicine research team has also developed different kind of technologies.
You can see that it's an 8-story building, and at rooftop we've also got a greenhouse. Most of them would be laboratories, and one floor is an office, and also the ground floor is a plant room. And there are also advanced facilities for research, for example, the state key laboratory, and also high-precision instruments such as electron microscopes, X-ray diffractometers, and also mass spectrometers, and also a greenhouse for plant biotechnology researchers, and also research facilities for animal models of human diseases. So we have animal holding facilities, and also computational and data center for bioinformatics research, and also teaching platform, and also for plant samples and so on. So the site would also have to meet very strict acoustic and also environmental requirements. It has to be vibration proof, and also the site is very simple. So it's a rectangular shape site. We have auditoriums and also some laboratories and so on. So that's the ground floor. And then first floor is an office building. And then from third to seventh floor, as you can see, they are very down-to-earth office type premises. And then at rooftop, we have two gardens. And as I said, there would also be a greenhouse. So all in all, the total NOFA is 12,000 square meters, and then there are 9 floors, and then for laboratories, that will take up about 85%, and office would be 10%, and then for facilities, about 5%. So that will take up about 5% of NOVA, and then it will cost about $1.4 billion. And if the project is approved by the FC, then it will start works in 2021 for completion in 2024. Total area, as I just said, for NOVA is about 12,000 square meters, and the distribution has also been set. And then we have already completed the tendering exercise for the project, and today, with your support, in December, we would like to get the approval from the PWSC, and then in January, we'll go to FC for approval. And then for site formation, it will start soon, and then it will start works in March for completion in 2024. Okay, next, Hong Kong U. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, we have two projects that are before members. Yes, I'm afraid we will have to extend the meeting a little bit by at least 15 minutes. So I'll declare that I'll extend the meeting by 15 minutes. And I can see that we've already got 8 in the queue for asking questions. We might have to extend it by another 15 minutes so that members will be able to ask whatever questions that you may have. And I'm sure you're all very concerned about this item, so that's what I'm proposing. Okay, are you ready with the PowerPoint presentation? Okay. So for others who are interested in this item, please raise your hands and I'll have to draw a line. Even if I try to extend it, we have to draw a line. So 9 members have indicated that they'd like to ask questions. Okay, is everything ready? Yes, Madam Chair. That being the case, so can I just do the presentation orally? Yes, there are two projects involving the Hong Kong U. One would be Building 1. In fact, it's the laboratory building. And the other one is an IT building, an information technology building. Both would be located at University Drive. And there is an overall planning. And then after the Centenary Campus, the main campus, towards the west of it, we plan to use the eastern side for Science and Engineering Center. And the two projects that we have put before you, that would also increase science and researcher space. Project 1, Building 1, is at number 2 University Drive. Okay, it's ready. Well, because of time limit, please be brief. Yes, there are many questions. Yes, I'll be brief. Well, for the first item, that's to the north of University Drive, there'll be a laboratory building, and to the south, we're going to build an IT building, so that would be near the hillside. And then if you pass by University Drive, you pass by both. At present, at Building 1, initially it's a staff quarters, and after it's demolished, we'll be building this laboratory building, and there'll be 20 teams working there. They will be conducting researches, and space will be made available for promotion of interactive learning. And then for the new laboratory, there will be two projects. One would be core analysis and also quantity or nuclear or macromolecular technology laboratories and so on. So this is the location. And at the front, we have escalators and also stairs to go up to the building. And on the right-hand side, this is the existing research or graduate students hall. And right next to it is the Minghua complex. And this is to look at it from another side. Okay, it's a rectangular building. And then we have the chemistry building and also physical science building. And then on the top left-hand corner, it's connected to the existing campus, and you can have access to the centenary campus, and there is another entrance to classrooms. And then on the first floor, basically, we have classrooms and also laboratories and also office accommodation. And then from the second to the fourth floor, altogether there are three stories, and the purpose is to have the laboratory for teaching, and also there are also some classrooms. And then from the fifth to the eighth floor, altogether four stories, the main laboratories would be for researchers. So the total NOVA is 7,100 square meters. Over half of them would be for laboratories, some 4,200 square meters. And then the rest would be classrooms and so on. We have already started the tendering exercise. Yes, Tommy Zhang. In fact, we have already got a printout, and if he's trying to go through each and every bit of it, we won't be able to end by 2 p.m. Yes, point taken, Mr. Zhang. Well, as I said, you will have to complete in 2 minutes. There is no way that we can accommodate everything, because 8 members would like to ask questions. Thank you. The next would be the IT building. And there we're going to have a data center with 150 computers. Next is a photo montage, and from the top of it, this is the IT building, and from the fourth to the seventh, they'll be connected to the main building. And then next, you can see where the harbor is and also where the building is. Well, first, second, and third floor, these are the lower stories. Well, there will be power plant and also all the plant rooms. And then starting from the fourth floor, there will be learning facilities. It will also be connected to building one. And then fifth floor is the data center. That's the main area. And then sixth to seventh floor, that's the IT teaching laboratory and classroom. And then the eighth floor is a common and supporting facilities. So total area 5,300 square meters. Most of them will be sharing facilities and also complementary facilities. And then for the IT building, the project, like the building one project, we have already done the tendering exercise in tandem. And then if everything goes smoothly, if we're able to go to the FC next year, then in February we will start works, and then it will be completed in 2024. So these are the information about the two buildings. I'm not going to repeat that here. Okay, members may start to ask questions. Tommy Zhang, 3 minutes, including both questions and answers, and I'll turn off your mic once the time is up. I don't need that much. Well, Madam Chair, I need to declare interest because I've been elected by this council to represent this council to sit in the Senate of the Chinese Yu. So I'm interested in the Chinese Yu. Well, they need this building. I'm not going to go into the details because I'd like to give you more time to ask questions. The Liberal Party supports the Chinese Yu's application. We are not against the University of Hong Kong's proposal. Do you need the representatives to respond? No. Okay, next one. Claudia Mo. Well, we talk about the campus development for universities. In principle, nobody would say no to that. But then what is regrettable is that every time when we talk about Hong Kong's universities, well, inevitably, what comes to my mind would be the attacks by the police at these universities, the Poly U, the Chinese U, and so on. And we were told that Hong Kong U has been lucky in the sense that it was left out because it's a school or a campus was full of heritage. So I'd like to ask the university representatives, can you reiterate that for your new vice chancellor or senior vice chancellor, he's not going to be a party member of the CCP? Well, this has nothing to do with the project. Yes, the project is a hardware, but then for the new incumbent, he's the software. So I'd like to know if he's going to answer that question as well. So will you be prepared to answer the question? Can you just put it to him? I believe that this question has nothing to do with the item under discussion. Okay. All you need to do is to say no. The only thing that I'm concerned about the Chinese youth is that in the laboratory complex, you said that there are some laboratories. Well, it's about the animal model for human diseases. So it's an animal lab. You talk about animal holding facilities. That's scary. So you're talking about cats, dogs, and also rats and monkeys and rabbits. So will you be using animals for testing and so on? Who is to answer? Chinese Yu. It's Chinese Yu. So is Mr. Yu going to answer? Please be brief. Yes, Professor Wong. Well, for all the Hong Kong universities, we do have very strict ethical committees will have to approve what we do. And on the top floor, we also have animal holding facility. Very often it's just testing on mice and so on. So they're just guinea pigs. What about fish? Most of them, well, in fact, we have to go through very stringent procedures for approval. Mostly would be using small rats for animal studies to look at certain diseases. So we need to do tests on animals. What about cats and dogs? I'm not aware of that. I'm not aware of any laboratory tests using cats and dogs. So for animal tests and laboratories, you would not be using cats, dogs, and monkeys, and so on. So you would mainly be using rats or mice. Yes, what about rabbits? Well, sometimes we would use rabbits for taking serum and so on. So can you confirm that no cats and dogs whatsoever? Because I'm concerned that you might be catching stray cats and dogs on the streets. No. Okay, Lo Wai Kwok. Madam Chair, first of all, I'd like to say that together with the my other colleagues from the BSF, the Business and Professional Alliance, we support the projects. These are the projects proposed by the Chinese Yu and Hong Kong Yu. We support those. But then I'd like to raise a very important issue. Well, science research is not just about hardware. Most importantly, it's about talents. Since last year, when we had the social unrest, and until now, we have the COVID pandemic. So does it have any impact on talents coming to Hong Kong? Because I understand that for universities and also members of the public, the memories are still fresh because universities have been vandalized by the black-clad youth. And when people come to Hong Kong, initially they have a very nice campus to pursue their studies, and instead they will have to flee in a hurry. So this is really very bad.
So in terms of human resources or manpower, is there obvious changes? Even if we have the hardware, do we lack the talents? Professors, thank you, member, for your question. We can assure the member in terms of recruiting talent, the effect was not too much. But rather, it is because of the COVID that the arrival of some talents are delayed. But generally speaking, in terms of human resources on research, we are very happy about the current situation. And we have a very important appointment in our neuro research center that we are going to announce soon. So we are happy with the situation. The neuroscience center. Actually, our answer is the same as CUHK. For the HKU, we don't find it very difficult to absorb talents. Quite the contrary, the COVID situation is affecting Europe and Australia and also the US seriously. So we want to invite more talents or scientists to Hong Kong. Now, currently, many of them are coming to Hong Kong and they have to go through quarantine in Hong Kong. What about mainland students? Under the current circumstances, for them to come back to for school or to do research, what's the situation? Now, for research students, for research graduates and they have come back, but for undergraduates, they still need more time to come back. Ms. Alice Mack, I'm elected by the electrical member to sit on the IMC of the CUHK. I'm not going to ask questions like the other member asked, whether a certain professor is a party member. First, it is irrelevant to the topic, and also Dr. Fernando Zheng, Helena Wong, Mr. Chen Kellogg, and also the chairman, you all have taught in the schools, in the universities, but you have your own political affiliation as well. So that's allowed. Now, we support the works in both universities. A member mentioned that CUHK in the last year have been rampaged by the black-clad people. I am a CUHK graduate. I have strong feelings, a strong attachment to the campus. I don't want to see anyone damaging our campus so that the police need to go into the campus to enforce the law. Last year, several universities had a campus damaged. The Poly U's laboratory had some chemicals stolen. So for the security of the laboratory in CUHK, how tight is it? Some say we should not lock up the university. However, we were told by some CUHK students, at that time, many people inside the campus were not actually students. So how can we make sure that the facilities are secured, and how can we maintain the safety of students and teachers in the campus? President Ng, concerning security, of course, it is of our utmost concern, especially the safety of our teachers and students. They should be able to seek knowledge safely in school. So since last year's incidents, we have stepped up security. For those entering the campus, they will have to go through a certain level of check. We will check their identification documents to see whether they have legitimate reasons to enter the campus. Of course, campus is open to students, teachers, and other public members. For places with sensitive information, for example, libraries, with valuable properties, we have stepped up security as well. We have engaged a consultant to provide us with security advice in terms of enhancing security on hardware and software. Sorry, at the other university, we have to wait for the comprehensive reply. Mr. Yip Kin-yun, Chair, we still remember in the end of November last year, on this panel, we have scrutinized funding for universities. However, in the Finance Committee, the item was withdrawn. It dealt a huge impact on the development of universities. So I urge members across the political spectrum to focus on the development of universities and not to do anything hampering the development of universities. Last time's funding involved medical courses and so on. This time, the funding is for public works on biomedicines and so on, and also information technology. These are very important in our education. For example, biotechnology. Internationally, we have achieved a lot in this field. In the funding, this time, many fundings are involved in building laboratories. Developments of laboratories actually have been held up for a long time. Our laboratories have not been improved along the years. So we are lagging behind the state-of-the-art laboratories in international institutions. And also, we have a limit to our recruitment of talents are limited by the lack of the proper hardware. So we are not just talking about building buildings in this proposal. It is very important for our developments in R&D. We can bring in more talents with these projects, and also it will help training more talents. So I would like to ask the Education Bureau. Now we have the buildings, we have the facilities, and we will bring in more talents. These all cost money. So in terms of the fundings, with these buildings and laboratories built, do we still have enough funding for developments in these specialties? Under Secretary, please. Chair, for these public works, they will be funded by the 16 billion provision, except for the second one, and no recurrent funding will be required. We will distribute, we will deploy the resources through the UGC. These buildings will be operated by the university themselves. Now it is my turn. I have a declaration of interest to make as well. I am a graduate of HKU and the CUHK, so I have a keen interest, and also I am teaching in the CTU. I don't think that is in conflict of today's topic. Just now, many members voiced their concern over the CUHK. Last year, there was a serious violent clash which took place there. I have no concerns about the academic qualities of both universities, and I respect your proposal for those buildings. Across the political spectrum, members have voiced their concern about the development of the universities. So please respond to our expectation and the expectation of society. Besides bringing in talents for scientific developments, and you have a lot of good professors, in universities, some faculties are only concerned with writing papers. Now you have funding for building facilities as well. But what about the quality of your students? If you love them, you have to reprimand them. There were graduates or even undergraduates of the CUHK which used a lot of vulgar languages. It is very sad for this to happen in my alma mater. You have my votes for confidence in developing your hardware. But despite having a lot of exceptional scientists, what about their social responsibility? Now, it's all right to have the funding, but what about helping the students to develop a sense of responsibility for society? Chair and members, I thank you for your concern. This is a good opportunity because we are preparing our 5-year strategic plan and also the report to be approved by the UGC. So we will review our education in terms of moral education. In terms of nurturing students morally, we will try to step up our efforts. Dr. Fernando Zheng. Dr. Zheng is not here. Ms. Eunice Yong, Chair. I also support the three proposals. Sorry, some house matter. Because of the time, I would like to seek your support for extending the meeting for another 15 minutes. There's no objection, so we will continue. Ms. Eunice Yong, Chair, I support these three proposals, including the campus development works of CHK and HKU. Many members voiced the concern about the black-clad violence in Poly-U, CTU, HKU, and CHK. They were hijacked by the black-clad people as an armory. CUHK was seriously damaged. All the traffic transport facilities outside the campus are damaged. I also studied there. I felt sad as well. It is supposed to be a place to protect the students and citizens, but it was damaged to such an extent. It is utterly unacceptable to everyone. The maintenance cost for these three universities last year was at 900 million. Now, this time, the funding involved are 1,416 million or 500 million something, and the other one is $600 million. The $900 million for repairing could be used to build one and a half of such buildings. Because of the black clad violence last year, our money was put to ditches. Actually, we could spend those money on civic education. However, because of the black clad violence, the money was wasted, and our time was wasted, and our faith in the universities were damaged. I'm even more concerned about education in primary school, secondary school, and even kindergarten. University may be too late, so I want to push forward national education earlier on so students can grow up more healthily. On these items about the core analytical equipment inside the technology building, there are many advanced equipment. Do we have these equipment right now? And after the project, are you going to buy new equipment or are you going to use the old equipment? And also you said 20 teams will carry out research in the building. Do we already have those 20 teams or do we have to hire other teams?
Bolong from Chinese U. So I'll be telling you more about that building in the Chinese U. In fact, some of the instruments would be existing ones and they'll be moved in. But then some new instruments would also be procured because of the updating and upgrading needs. As to the number of teams to be stationed there, at present, we have already got incumbent teams working at the Chinese U. Well, of course, there will be replacement, there will be natural wastage, people will retire and so on. So we've been very active in recruiting new recruits. Next, Roy Kwong. Madam Chair, of course, I support Chinese U and Hong Kong U on these two projects because in the past, some of them didn't come through. So, for example, the medical school facilities of Chinese U and Hong Kong U, the administration said that there were concerns from members. That's why those items were withdrawn. Of course, those would be the loyalists. And in the end, there was a delay of some 6 months, and then some $1.6 billion was approved finally by the FC. I hope that the Secretariat would put on record. That is, my views are very simple, and I'm grateful to the two universities and their colleagues for coming to give us an update. Because for Chinese U and Hong Kong U, they're rebuilding the IT buildings and also a comprehensive research laboratory building. So I don't see any reason for rejecting that. I hope that they can expedite the whole progress. Well, the paper says that they'll be completed in 2024. All right, Hong Kong is a small place, but then in terms of R&D, we have been doing a remarkable job. And in the past, the results are for raw to see. But then it's only confined to the hardware. And even if you have very good hardware, if you don't have the right talents, and if the construction is not in the right time, so they will not be able to do a good job, and therefore we have an unshakable responsibility to help them. All right, in the paper you said that you're very modest and you hope that you'll be able to do better in different areas. So I'd like to ask the Bureau, number one, for these projects, is there a chance that you can expedite it? And also, would there be a possibility or a risk that they will fail in the end? So can you tell us? Two universities, who will speak first? What about the Undersecretary? Well, in fact, we've been working very hard to promote these university projects. And if everything goes smoothly, then according to this, it's already the fastest that we can work on, because it takes time to build the buildings. And then for future projects, we will also work very hard. Recently, in fact, in the last budget, the administration has already set aside $16 billion for universities to build laboratories and also campus renovation. Thank you. Okay, the Undersecretary, please make sure that it won't fail in the end. I hope that it'll be put on record that I fully support this. And in fact, all right, under the leadership of the chair lady, you can see that members from all walks of the political affiliation are in support of this. In fact, for students, this is something good, because if the universities can do it, I don't want the sad history to repeat itself again. And you'd also have the responsibility. Yes, you might not have wanted it to happen. Still, you will have to work very hard, because these resources are very reasonable, because we're using public money to engage or to enable the universities to do more research. Next, Lau Kofan. Thank you, Madam Chair. I have to declare interest, because I'm also a Senate member of the Chinese U. With regard to these research facilities of the two universities, I support them, because Hong Kong needs to do more in innovation and research and development, in particular in the Greater Bay Area and also at the state level. I'm sure Hong Kong will make important contributions. So my question is, concerning the Chinese U laboratory, they'll be able to study climate change and agriculture, and it's also going to be a state key laboratory of agro biotechnology. So for this lab, it will be collaborating with some state labs, right? So how is it going to take place? Who is to answer? Professor Leung? Well, it's a state key laboratory. In fact, the whole policy is that we would allow outstanding teams to be selected in Hong Kong, and we've been very honored that we have been chosen to set up this state key laboratory of agro biotechnology. And then this is going to be set up in Hong Kong, and at present we have some 24 professors, and they formed a team, and some 19 are from the Chinese U and 3 are from Hong Kong U. 3 would be from Baptist U, and they are working in support of Hong Kong's own scientists engaging in research that would affect food supply in the world. So they are looking into these areas. Yes, Hong Kong U, any response? Well, just now I was putting the question to Chinese U. So I hope that these research laboratories, well, in Hong Kong, at the universities, they have been doing a remarkable job. But then when it comes to application and also about commercialization of these outcomes, I hope that you can make improvements. So my question for the two universities, for these research projects, other than doing the research, when it comes to application and commercialization, so that we can make contribution to our state, I understand that Chinese U, for example, they've been working on a particular project. So at this laboratory, will you be able to come up with some outcomes that can be applied? All right, all members have already asked their questions, and I've already promised that I'll give the two universities to respond to some of these questions, in particular the Hong Kong U, because very often, just now the Chinese U has been able to make some responses, but not the Hong Kong U. Well, society has some concerns, and I hope that today is a very good opportunity for you to respond to that. So I'll be giving you the opportunity. Hong Kong U, yes, Professor Ng. Yes, the last question first. It's about the incubation. In fact, we have set aside a place at the IT building at the connecting bridge. We are going to enlarge the iDendron setup so that students would be able to do incubation work there. And then for some research outcomes, they could also use that for startups. So that's being done. And Madam Chair, I think the question is, you do have expectation on us, and we are fully aware of that. But then for this particular project, I'm sure, Madam Chair, you understand that it's focused on technology and engineering. And then for Hong Kong U, humanities, 10 years ago, when we had the centenary campus, a lot of provision has been made for humanities subjects. And then for sciences and engineering, for the existing buildings, they are already 30, 40 years old, and they are very run down. And therefore, the idea behind these projects is to enable students, if they indeed would be able to make a concrete contribution to a society through sciences, engineering, and so on, we'd like them to be passionate about this, and they would need to have a sense of belonging. So that's the reason why we built these buildings. Okay, next, we will have to seek members' views on this. So do you agree that we should submit this to the PwC for discussion? If there is no objection, then I'm sure we are all in agreement. So first of all, I'd like to thank the representatives from the two universities as well as the Bureau, and they've answered some of the questions. We will still have more chances to discuss issues involving the universities. So today is not the end of it. So you've already answered questions in relation to your faculties, but then there are issues that you will have to bring back to your universities, because we have high hopes on the universities. Okay, next item. Next item is a follow-up item, because in considering or looking into kindergartens, secondary and primary schools, textbooks, and also the textbook committee, we haven't finished the work. In fact, we will continue with this work, and we welcome members who have yet to join to join. So in this regard, does anyone wish to speak? Yes, Eunice Yong. Yes, I'm concerned that for this study on kindergarten, the subcommittee to study the development of textbooks and teaching materials for kindergarten, primary, and secondary schools. Well, last time we tried to elect our chairman and deputy chairman. Still, we have not been able to do it. So, Madam Chair, can we discuss it here? If by the next meeting we are still not able to do it, let's say if we spend an hour and still we have not been able to elect a chairman and deputy chairman, then what can we do about it? So how are we going to deal with the agenda for the subcommittee? Yes, I've thought about this. Thank you very much for your question. So I'll leave it to the subcommittee to see if you are able to elect your chairman and deputy chairman. And if you're still stuck there, then we'll see if that item can be brought up for discussion at the panel. Okay? Yes? Roy Kwong? Madam Chair, let me supplement. Okay, it's a new year, and then the subcommittee will be reactivated, and I'm sure. So it's very simple. You will have to leave it to the subcommittee, because you don't have to be over worried. So let's see how things go. Okay, I hope that there would not be just one voice when it comes to this item. Okay, we'll see how things go. Thank you. Thank you, Eunice. and thank you for staying behind for the end of the meeting. Okay, meeting is now adjourned. Thank you.